and the second negative, and I'll be opposing the first and second affirmative. As Oregon was the very first state to legalize physician-assisted suicide due to death with Dignity Act, advocates who supported the bill suspected that other states would also follow Oregon's actions. They were wrong. It took another 14 years before another state legalized its own version of the bill after advocates took a whole year in preparing a campaign and raising billions of dollars to grasp the victory they wanted. The state which legalized the Death with Dignity Act was Washington, a state which shared demographic similarities with Oregon, which could have been a possible reason for its legalization. Drawing from the statistics in the 2013 census, it is evident that the percentage shared for Caucasians, Hispanics or Latinos, Asians, and African Americans among Oregon and Washington are so similar that they are only 1 to 5% apart from each other. In May 2013, the state of Vermont also legalized passed the Death with Dignity Act, which is adapted from Oregon as well. Since Oregon's legalization of physician-assisted suicide in 1994, many states have rejected the bill several times. Since January 1994, there have been more than 140 legislative proposals within 27 states. Although the Vermont bill in 2013 was passed, all other bills which are not currently pending were either defeated, tabled for session, withdrawn by sponsors, or died with no action taken. From the information given, the workability of legalizing the Death with Dignity Act within all states is highly unlikely due to this long and complicated process. Going into the background of Washington's official reports of the Death with Dignity Act, the backgrounds of its work started in 1991. By a vote of 54 to 46%, Washington state voters defeated Initiative 119, a measure that would have permitted doctors to provide euthanasia by lethal injection. Over the course of three attempts in Washington to transform assisted suicide, the all resulted in failure as advocates wanted assisted suicide, which was a crime in Washington at the time, to become legal and considered to become medical treatment. Finally, in 2008, advocates succeeded as the ballot votes were 57 to 42%, which made it legal for doctors to help their patients commit suicide. Washington's Death with Dignity Act law is similar to that of Oregon's. The opponent claimed that enacting Oregon's Death with Dignity Act nationwide would grant terminally ill the right to end their lives as it would relieve suffering and produce compassion, but the chances of it happening are unlikely as it took advocates for the act almost 20 years to finally make another state legalize the bill. Along with the legalization of the bill, several disadvantages become apparent as well within the categories of health insurance companies, abuse, and palliative care. The most controversial topic of conversation within physician-assisted suicide is the cost savings in which insurance can gain. The estimated cost savings from permitted physician-assisted suicide are lower than many people expect. The reason for this disparity is because of the overestimation of how much is spent on medical care at the end of one's life. According to Washington Post, it is speculated that 70 to 90% of our healthcare dollars spent on the last few months of life, while other analysts from Art Intermed suggest that the cost of care for dying patients account for almost 30% of all healthcare expenditures. while the actual statistical data from Emmanuel EJ from JAMA presents that only about 10% of expenditures for medical care involves patients who die. As a result, the less amount of costs spent on patients who die, the smaller the cost savings from physician-assisted suicide. The disparity, however, still exists as the situation in Oregon involves a woman named Barbara Wagner was prescribed with a drug from her doctor that would likely extend her life and make it more comfortable. Her state insurance program, however, refused to authorize payment for it and instead sent her a letter saying they would pay for doctor-prescribed suicide. Although the health insurance company may have its reasons for offering such a crushing statement, the option of saving expenditures by granting assisted suicide is unethical. As a result of all this, according to the Oregon Public Health Division, the number of patients who have had private insurance, which is 43.5%, was lower in 2013 than in previous years, which was 64.7%. And the number of patients who had only Medicare or Medicaid insurance was higher than in previous years as well, which is 53.2% compared to 33.7%. As residents now have the option of ending their lives along. With the disparity issue, the issue of abuse raises several questions as well. As of 2007, the suicide rates within Oregon were 35% higher than the national average. Although the safeguard measures are installed into the Death with Dignity Act, several instances are counted and not reported where abuse was evident. In Michael Freeland's case in Vermont, the safeguard measures were not met. Mr. Freeland requested and received a lethal prescription from Dr. Peter Regan, a suicide advocate, after a few months of being diagnosed with lung cancer. Dr. Regan offered to refill the prescription when he outlived the six-month limit. Over a year after receiving the prescription, Mr. Freeland was admitted to a psychiatric treatment facility with depression and suicidal intent. After he was treated, professional caregivers ensured that he had 32 guns, and they ensured that his 32 guns and all his ammunition were removed from his home before he allowed to return, but they allowed to keep his lethal prescription given by Dr. Peter Regan. After the day of discharge, his treating physician wrote a letter to the court saying that Mr. Freeland was not competent and required a guardian. Accidentally calling physicians for compassionate care when he meant to call the suicide advocacy organization, Compassion in Dying, the physicians helped him through his last several months of life after saying that his depression was treated aggressively. He died naturally and comfortably nearly 2 years after receiving his lethal prescription. As a result of this, he signed a medical release of his records for public view, and it became evident that the safeguards failed to protect him. There was an incorrect prognosis for from Dr. Regan, as Mr. Freeland was not within 6 months of dying, and Dr. Regan also prescribed a lethal drug to a depressed patient. Even after the courts determined that Mr. Freeland was not competent and needed a guardian, he was still allowed to keep his lethal prescription. Although the Death with Dignity Act does not allow patients on psychiatric problems to be prescribed, patients with psychiatric problems to be prescribed with a lethal life-ending drug, several holes exist in the system that allow abuse, which in turn leads to a higher suicide rate within the country. In addition, the disadvantage of abuse within the system, palliative care will also decrease. According to Herbert Hendricks' congressional testimony in 1996, he states that the Netherlands has become a frightening laboratory experiment because assisted suicide and euthanasia have meant that pressure for improved hospice and palliative care appears to have evaporated. As one of the only three foreign observers given the opportunity to study Netherlands medical practices, he documented and discussed specific cases which show that assisted suicide has not become the rare exception, but the rule for people with terminal illnesses. Hendricks emphasizes that patterns and statistics from the United States for patients requesting lethal drugs have increased and may eventually resemble Netherlands numbers. He states that over the past 2 decades, Netherlands has moved from assisted suicide to euthanasia to euthanasia for the terminally ill to euthanasia for the chronically ill, from euthanasia for physical illness to euthanasia to psychological distress, and from voluntary euthanasia to non-voluntary and involuntary euthanasia. Although the numbers of requesting assisted suicide was low in the Netherlands from the beginning as well, the trend of social acceptance of the act eventually led them to the place where they are now. Although legalization within the United States is possible after more than 20 years, the result will in turn resemble Netherlands statistics in the extraordinary growth that has already taken within the United States. Thank you.